Delta State, Nigeria. I came because of one man who has been doing wonderful things in Nigeria. He's actually a philanthropist and he has humanitarian gestures in him. He's one of our recipients for a giant award coming later on in the United Kingdom. And we decided to come down and see what he's doing for humanity and his ministry. What is it all about? Where did he get his spiritual powers? And lots more. We're going to be talking to that great man. He is Jeremaih Omoto Fufeyin, and he is the founder of Christ Marcellan Deliverance Ministry in Warri, Nigeria. It's going to be a great one. If you miss this, don't touch it down. We'll be right back. Appreciate what you're doing for God and mankind. We are here to see you, sir. Can you tell our viewers watching you all over Europe as you speak, who is Jeremaih Omoto Fufeyin and what do you represent?
God bless you. Viewers all over the world, I am Prophet Jeremaih Omoto Fufeyin. I thank God for this interview. I am a prophet by special grace of God. Number one, I have not started this ministry by myself. It is God that started with me. I really, I was on the mountain of fire, miracle ministries, and as a prayer warrior. And the Lord God really, really blessed me there as a prayer warrior. I was praying for the Haro year in Warri. Something just happened. When they saw the miracles that had taken place right in the Warri year, and the people decided and they drove me. They said they don't want me anymore in this place. They said I am using other power apart from the power of God. And God really, 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 really surely behind me. To an extent, they said I should go on my own, and I left them. And I cried to God. I said, God, really, if really you are the one that will call me, please use me to the whole world and let the people begin with my people, the people that have drove me, let them begin to see what you have sent me for. I don't think that I will become like this by special grace of God. Today, this ministry is the day they drove me to today is making 5 years, 3 months. By special grace of God, God is too great. And this 5 months, 3 months, by special grace of God, we are controlling more than 25,000 people. God is really, really great. And when I started my own, even to an extent, the people that who are trustees in my the ministry, who supported me before, because I don't have any money and nothing to now start off. And God was so kind that these people that who supported me, something just happened. But these people, one day, I knew that the church politics today is greater than the politics PDP and APC played in Nigeria here. And these people, for no reason, and they now they've seen that after I left them, I left the church, Mountain of Fire, that how the people now knew that 1 year they want me, the people prophesize prophecies everywhere. That's 1 year this young man is using medicine, he's using charm, he's going to, everything's going to scatter and he's going to drop. So immediately after 1 year, 1 year later, these people now gathered together and they said, this boy is using the power of God. And they have found out they fasted, and some pastors in the Mount of Fire here in Warri, they fasted in a rejection, So, and they fasted and they found out God showed them, and they now sent to my elders who are the board of trustees. And these people now came to me and they said, I should go and join them. I said, how can I go and join them? The Lord said, I should not join them anymore. And that's how I now, and they left me. They left for Mount Fire back, and I was alone. So, and God was so kind that since I started, brethren, those who are watching me, God is really great. Things have been happening, and that even the people today, they surprise and they give thanks to God today. Okay. Thank you.
Fantastic. We've been here, we've seen the massive land that you have here, hectares of land.
Yeah.
And we've seen great humanitarian job you've been doing.
Yeah.
Why do you decide to help mankind? Why are you giving us money? Why are you giving us cars? Why are you giving us motorcycles? Why are you empowering people?
Okay.
From your calling as a pastor.
Okay, I am not a pastor, I am a prophet. I'm a prophet, yes. I'm a prophet of God. God really talked to me as you are talking to me. He sent his angels and he talked to me, and I heard from God and I hear his voice. What is there is that why I do help people is something that God told me that I is supposed to do, because I was helpless and God helped me. Now, look at what's happening right now here. By special grace of God, what's right happening here? All over the world, and pastors and people all over the world is surprised. 5 years, three months, cannot achieve such things that what's happening right now. If I want to call them, I mention them till tomorrow, the end would not come. But what I'm going to tell you right now, why I'm helping people, the Lord said, I, the Lord, I'm going to help you. Then you also help people. So, as if I don't help person, if I don't help person in a day, I fell into sickness. Take the Magdawo. If I don't help person, if I don't give money to a humanity, in a day, I fell into sickness. That how is, you know, in this church, like pregnant women, every pregnant woman that will give birth in the church, I give them 50,000 naira with baby teens. 50,000 naira. If a person give birth twins, I give them, I give them 50,000 each, which 100,000 naira twins. Even triplets, 150,000 with baby things, with the word of God, the Bible, each child. Then also, like look at the king, a king came from Benue State, and who was a king, and he turned to taxi driver. And he came, I'm a prophet, and the Lord showed me the story of the man. And I now prophesied to him. After his prophecy, I blessed him with a car, a jeep, and I gave him money. A million, naira. So that's how I've been helping people. Not only one, like an actor who was sick. His name is called Ernest Asuzu, a well-known actor in Nigeria. He was sick and was about to die. He was mad. He was even defecating himself. He was urinating himself, but he doesn't know. Was mad for 4 good years, and he brought this man, and I sent for him. When I saw this on the net, I sent for him. Then now he came, and I took care of him, paid even one of the tests, gave him a free accommodation, and taking care of him every week, 50,000 naira, until 1 year and 2 months. 50,000 every week, which is a month, is 200,000 naira, free accommodation, until he became okay. And after the day that he's about to go, he has gone last 3 weeks. And I bought a car, a jeep of 4 million naira. And I gave him cash of 1.5 million naira. And now the man is happy. That is what God sent me to do. So when babies and other people are now coming all over here, and people are now receiving, people that I don't know, whether your wife, your sisters, your brother, so the wife, they come, they give birth, I give them money. And I've been doing this thing to people. Not only these people. People have been, I cannot count.
Okay, on our platform, we choose to celebrate Nigerians who are doing wonderful things anywhere they are, anywhere in the world. We look out for them, and that's why we are in worry. How can people, black people in the diaspora, or white people, or whoever who's watching you as we speak now on our global platform, how can they tap into this opportunity if they have spiritual issues?
Okay, this opportunity is something that how can somebody will tap from this?
Yeah, how can they see you?
See
how
this
they
one?
Have access?
Yes, the access.
Deliverance.
Yes. I don't know what is called media before, but God is so great that today many people. Let me just tell you something. People all over the world, and one day You've never asked that question. When you ask that question, I'll answer you about TB Joshua. I'll come. How can somebody go to tap on this one? We have our media. We go to the show, social media. Is this in? I'm going to display it. www.mercytelevision.org. Jeremaih Ministries.
Okay, can they come to Nigeria and see what you are doing?
Yeah, they can come to Nigeria. And men have come. Our own, we do it practical. No grammar. No grammar. What the Bible, the days of old, what our brothers and sisters, our brethren, Elijah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, what they've been doing before. Dry bones rise again, and dry bones rose up. That's what we also do. Because many, even the babies that have died and come back to life, men, even people that who are about to die, who are hospital, says this person is dead. Like we have something called Pool of Bethesda here. There's a water called Pool of Bethesda. When I was in Israel, the Lord just, shown that, minister to me, that this water, the Pool of Bethesda here, that is in the Bible, he just took it. That time, I don't have land before. But God was so kind. Immediately said, you took this when you get to Nigeria, get back to Nigeria, and you go to now dig a place. After digging that place, you get to dug it. You get to dig a place. When you dig that place, what you going to do? People will come from all over the world, and I'm going to pour into my power. My power, this the Pool of Bethesda, my power into this water, and you're going to use this water to people, and people are going to listen. And many people today, if you see the video clips, you will marvel. You see this video clip, people that who not one, not two, not three. These people, doctor rejected them, and now whatever thing that the Pool of Bethesda yield them back to that. If you see their body rotten. Oh no, okay, let me just tell you something that happened. That one is just something that I have spoken my power. It is called a prayer mat. That was something that I have spoken my power. A man was just brought with ambulance. A medical doctor referred with his two nurses, with two ambulance, because the case beyond is control. He couldn't do it again. He now sent them. He sent them to me, to the church, and I now they came, and this man was lifeless, and they brought him on stretch, and from there. I now just put this, the prayer mat, and this man, a police officer, and the man immediately came back to life with the drips, and I removed the drips, and today the man is alive. He is testifying. Just cases that who are about to die, doctors have abandoned, many that they are today, they are alive. You want to see the video clips? My boys, the media is going to now play them.
We're going to check.
So that it's not film trick.
Yeah, it's not film trick. Not okay, film fantastic. Trick. I've seen a couple of things there. Yeah. Well, I would like to ask you, a lot of people liking your spiritual power to TB Joshua, but do you have any association with TB Joshua?
Okay, thank you for that question, because that's the first thing that even TB Joshua, the great man of God, even asked me. He asked me, because when people saw me on the net, they now mailed him, according to him, and now we now spoke on phone. When I spoke on phone with him on phone, he said, where are you? And I began to introduce myself to him. And he said, people now talk of calling you. People said, oh, that's your son in worry. He's performing like you. We want to see him in Lagos. And he now got, who are you? So from there, I now introduced myself to him. So from there, I now, after the introduction, he said, it's a good thing. God is really surely behind you. Go, keep on. So even himself, he doesn't know before. I've never one day that I've gone to TB Joshua before the sin, before the anointing just came on. And people don't begin to know, I love the man. I love TB Joshua. Why I love him? Because when I was in a dry fasting, no food, no water, for 21 days, dry fasting. And on the 19th days, I died, and I woke up on the 20th day, and I turned to a skeleton. I was like a skeleton. I couldn't eat a solid food for good 20 days, solid food. Because there was sores inside my throat. So because of that, on the process, like I was saying, on the process, on the fasting, this man, all great men of Nigeria, all of them appeared to me, and they taught me things that I need to know. spiritually. But TB Joshua, some of them appeared to me two times, some thrice, but this TB Joshua, as a prophet, a great man of God, appeared to me 10 good times. And it taught me, it was like real, as we are talking, one-on-one. And it taught me things that I am going to carry out after the assignment of the program. And I told TB Joshua all these things. So, Daddy, you taught me all these things. And I've never seen him before in my life, but spiritually, he taught me all these things. And when I started, I began to now behave like him. Though my background is from mountain of fire, I began to behave like him. And people now said, people to call me Wari TB Joshua, Delta TB Joshua, Ijo, because I am from Ijo, okay. Ijo by tribe in Nigeria. So, the people called me TB Joshua of Niger Delta, TB Joshua of this thing. TB Joshua is a great man of God. And because of what I have experienced through him in the realm of the spirit when I was in 21 days dry fasting. Remember, the time when I was in a fasting, a young man in the so-called Delta State here, also five, General Vasia, the man died. Even today, as I'm talking right now, after breaking the fasting, the man died. His picture is right in my office. The man loses his life. To tell you that to do a dry fasting is not easy, okay, if God sent you. Okay. So, TB Joshua, I have seen him. When I saw him, it was the time that when met him, building collapse, collapse building. Right. That's all this thing. So, that's how. Okay. Because of my behavior, that's why.
Okay, you've been
my performances.
Okay. How have you been able to sustain the finances of having to help people in your ministry all the time? Where did you get all the funds?
Okay. Today, like I said, if I don't help person, I fell into sickness. You see, how do I get this money? Let me tell you something. The one that God blessed, God has blessed. Because there is nothing like Jesus. There's nothing like God. The kingdom of God is the highest, the richest, and the richest. Let me tell you something. God, where I got these finances is the people that I prayed for. The word that comes up, the Bible says in the book of John 6:63, the Bible says that the word that comes out from my mouth, they are life and they are spirit. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah 55:11-12, it says that the word that goes out from my mouth, they shall not return to me empty-handed. It shall come back with a good testimony, a good news. Let me tell you, when I speak something, God honor the word of the prophet. And anything that I speak, I have spoken to people that who are poor today. They are millionaires in the church today. I told people that who have no hope again. I spoke to them within a short time. These people become millionaires and billionaires. That way I get, because I received this money, not government. Though I have prayed for governors to become governors. Today, governors that I spoke to governors in Nigeria, two of them, I prayed for them, and they were nobody. They prayed for them, they were afraid. I prayed for them, they became governor. When I was about to buy this place, they promised me heaven and earth. Then I knew that politicians, they need deliverance.
Okay.
Are you hearing me? Yeah. So, politicians, the governor did not help me. The people that who are just came to the church that I prayed for, they are the people that will help me today. So that way, because if I pray for you today, the way you know you receive your blessings, your breakthrough, then what will you be to do? You have to come back to God. Say, God, that is my tithe. Thank you. That way I got my money.
Fantastic. I'm very, very privileged to be here. And I know a lot of people watching me right now in the United Kingdom and, of course, in the United States of America or anywhere in the world. We wonder how powerful that you are. Then again, I need to ask you this. Nigeria is going through a very, very bad economy right now. How can you use your ministry to help the masses who are downtrodden? How can we have a new orientation in Nigeria so that people can go to the Lord and serve God so that our country can be better? What are you pastors doing to that effect? Are you a prophet?
Okay. This economy, this what yeah, what's happening in Nigeria right now, as a prophet, last year, before crossover, December, there was a program held right in Mercy Land, I told the people that this is called, anything about to happen, God shown to me in Nigeria. And I whenever thing, I give them information before these things come to pass. I told them last year, November, December, that this thing, there is a great famine is coming. There's hunger is coming. Let everybody prepare for that. And but with prayers, God is going to overcome it. Crossover night, the clips are there, the video clips are there. And I said it openly. And everybody had it, that this year, there would be, this. There must be a famine. Hungry is coming. And the austerity, cost of living was very, very high. And I told them, people were joking about it. All these things, all these militants are taking place in Nigeria, I have prophesied. All of them I prophesied before today. All Ebola, before Ebola came to Nigeria, I prophesied before all those things. The clips are there. No magic. So, what you have, you asked just now, it's something that the Lord have shown me, and the Lord said, I should keep on praying, and He is going to show mercy upon Nigeria. Because economic meltdown, this one is too much. It's too much. That's what He told me, and I told them. So today, by prayer, we shall overcome.
Okay, fantastic. God bless you. I want you to use this opportunity to pray for a lot of Nigerians watching it, apart from Nigerians, all other national all other people from other nationalities, they need your prayer at this time. A lot of people in the diaspora doesn't want to live abroad, but because of the situation they find themselves, they have to emigrate to other countries in the world. They're watching you now. They are watching and they see a pastor, a prophet of God is giving them, oh, please pray for them.
Okay. Only one thing that I was going to tell you is this, that you never ask that surprising people in the whole world today that who have known me. People that were barren for many years, 30 years, 20 years, 28 years, 35 years, even for the menopause. They came with an apple. I pray for them. They carry their babies. Not one, not two, not three, not 30, not thousands. That program, every year we held it here. We held it here. And people are now on, we call it Apple Children. They are, we call it, I must carry my Samuel every year. And many barren women today. I don't think women are barren, because there's no barrenness in the Bible. And at that thing, there's a program we have. Once you hold this program, you can see that the video clips are there. The many testimonies that, surprise people, that who our doctor said, this amoropause, even some people that they have cutting off their wombs, are Philippian tubes. But today, my God, perform miracles. The clips are there. So, today, as I said, those who are watching me, I don't know what kind of problem you are facing all over the world. Today, I'm going to pray for you, because some people, they are facing marital challenges. Some people are facing a job. They are jobless. Some people, they are even facing what is this called, their papers are not okay. Their papers are not okay. Visas, their papers are not okay. Some people, they are facing health challenge. So the Bible says, with God, all things are possible. So let me tell you, viewers all over the world, I am your prophet, Omoto Jeremaih Fufeyin. I'm here to pray for you. There's no distance in prayer. Whatever you are, listen to me, and you're going to be blessed. Let me tell you, I want to speak to somebody right there, whatever place that's paying you, I want you to, whether you owe water, carry water, or you just place your hand in that place, I want to speak the power of God. There's no distance in prayer. As you're watching the television, as you hear me, I don't know the kind of problem you're passing through. Are you in prison, spiritual prison, physical prison, financial challenge you're passing through, barrenness, or you are now, you want to have a job? I don't know what kind of challenge you're passing through. You are in a court case. I don't know. You are in a sick bed. I don't know. But what I'm trying to tell you, to pray for you today, right now, because you're hearing my voice. The voice, the word that comes out from my mouth, the power. It carries power. Wherever you are, as from today, I stop that challenge that you are passing through in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever thing that you're looking for in life that you have lost long ago, you lose long ago, today I speak to you. You get to recover them in 100 folds, because you have come to me. Today I speak to you, whatever thing, whatever you want, you are due for marriage. There are many women, they are due for marriage, no husband. Today I speak to your life, wherever you are, you must receive your marriage, you must receive your husband, they must pay your bride price. In the name of Jesus Christ, I speak to you, that job that you are facing challenges, you must start your job right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, wherever you are watching me, you are now, you are barrenness, today you are barren. Anywhere you are barren, today I speak to you, you must carry a Samuel, you must carry your twins, you must carry your triplets in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever thing that you are in a sick bed, I say rise up and walk. That sick bed you are is not your bed. I say your daughter, your children that is sick, your boy, your son that is in sick bed, you that is in a sick bed, I say rise up and walk, because the word of God is power. I speak to your family, let prosperity locate your family. As you watch this program, your life will never ever remain the same. May God continue to bless you as you are going, as you're now going to your bed, as you are going to your workplace, as you are going out, as you are coming in, my God will protect you. The Bible says in the book of Psalm 121, the Lord will go with you and return with you. No accident will kill you, no untimely death. I speak to you once again as a prophet, Jeremaih Omoto Fufeyin. Receive your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Pastor. We appreciate you, and we have to find you all the way from the United Kingdom. We know that your ministry program is going to be playing on that channel, and a lot of people will be blessed through your ministry. We want to say thank you for giving us this wonderful opportunity, and we look forward to seeing you in the United Kingdom very, very shortly.
God bless you.
Thank you.
Bless you.
Viewers, it's been an interesting discourse with the man of God. I'm in worry. I'm blessed. And of course, I believe through that prayer, as you are blessed too. Prophet Jeremaih Omoto Fufeyin is going to be coming on our programs, so watch out for that. If you watch it, you will see wonderful things that he's been doing for mankind in Nigeria. And of course, he's going to be at the Nigerian Arise Award in November in London. If you want to join him, then let us know, give us a call, and we can arrange for you to visit if you have any spiritual problem you need to discuss with him. Aside from that, you can also call the church. We're going to put their numbers on the line, and of course, you can reach them on their social network platforms if you do have any problem, you need prayers from the ministry. This is where we have to wrap this program. We'll see you on the other side. Keep watching Ben Television, the first and the biggest black TV station in the United Kingdom. Welcome back to this special program. We want to say thank you for viewing loyalty. We owe to you where we get the best content from this continent, that is Africa, where we get to let you know what is trending as it is in Africa and in Nigeria as a whole. Today, we are talking celebrity journalism, and I've got a guru in the house who is very vast in that industry. This is a guy I've known for over 30 years of my journalistic experience, and is still doing well at it. He is the editor of Ovation International magazine and supervising editor for the Boss newspaper. He's been a journalist, trendy journalist at that, for that matter, for over 20 years in experience. He is a top celebrity journalist and very privileged. He's been abroad, he's been everywhere, world class. He's been with the Queen of England to Nigeria, and he was also at the wedding of Prince Charles and Camilla. What an experience, though. I'm very happy to have my friend in the house. Michael Efron.
Thank you, Larry.
Good to have you.
Thank you so much. Good to be here.
Yes. It's been a long while of journalism experience. And, you know, when you talk about celebrity journalism, I can say that Ovation started that in this part of the world.
Well, not really, but we could say that we started with, let's say, vintage people, prime people. Yeah. Fame and Comium, and it evolved to Ovation.
But Ovation actually glamorized it.
Yeah, we took it to the next level.
Okay. Celebrity journalism has been embraced now, and that's a normal way of life here.
Yes, it has. And that's one thing we have to say for Ovation, because now in all the newspapers, you'd see columns reporting celebrities, reporting fashion and style, which wasn't the case about 15, 20 years ago. So it was Ovation that actually broke the boundaries of celebrity journalism.
Okay, let's look at your profile now. You've been a Rolling Moss, Rolling Stone, Gathering Moss. You've been there for all the while. Over two decades of
of reporting.
Of reporting. How's it been with you?
Yeah, for me, it's been a passion. I mean, if you love something, you know, like I used to tell people, that the best form of work to do is when you're enjoying yourself and someone is paying you, or you're getting paid for doing your passion, writing, reporting, you know, as is a passion for me. And so my journey started, you know, I've worked in Radio Lagos, I worked in Concord, but I really got my journalism kicking at Fame, you know, where I was given a platform by my bosses to do reporting. I remember one of the, I started in Fame, you know, I started rolling with all the today's young millennials, but then it's the Silver Spoon kids. I used to report them, I used to how the roll around town, you know. That was how it all evolved.
Really. Okay, celebrity journalism, you're trying to get the best out of this world to showcase to the international world. Why showcasing Nigeria as a place to invest and come for tourism? What do you hear from on the street when you walk on the street of London or New York?
Well, basically, we try as much as possible, because the news circle shows Africa as a land of war, disease. The image I always see is that child with the fly around his or her mouth and all that. But that's not Africa. That's not all we are. That's not what we are. Okay. I mean, we enjoy big parties. We enjoy ourselves. We, even in the midst of the poverty, we still have time to relax. We still have people who are intelligent. We still have people who are doing great things. And that's the area we want to showcase. And that's what we've been doing for all these years.
But people have always blamed me for only kind of cover the elitist class. You know, does it really portray when you see an African or Nigerian party costing about 20 million naira, 30 million just to host a party, and Ovation will cover that? You make a lot of money, don't you?
We've had that criticism, but what we usually say is there are different genres of journalism. You can actually want to focus your magazine or your publication or your news program on the poor. And we have decided, we're not saying the rich, but we just want to share the good things about Africa. And then, who are these people that we've covered? If, for example, let's say an Aliko Dangote is having a party, he can afford to do any kind of party he wants. Let's say Mike Adenuga is having his daughter's wedding. I had the privilege of actually helping to coordinate it, because we were the official magazine for Bella Adenuga's wedding. So at least we were able to know how the nitty-gritty went, but they had money to enjoy themselves. You don't do a wedding twice except if there are some issues. So people want to spend a lot of money on their weddings, on their 50th birthdays. But out there, they even believe we still live on trees. So when we do those parties and they see the quality of what we do, it actually gives them a different perspective of Africa, that we don't live in trees. Okay. We actually have these good people around.
Well, I appreciate that, but people do say that politicians who have squandered our money or stolen our money are being celebrated by your
magazine. We actually don't celebrate anybody, really. We just show what they do. And I mean, if we're talking about Ovation, I can't remember too many politicians that we've actually really covered. I mean, just a few of their events, because we don't work with governments, we work with individuals.
Okay, well, let's look at the Nigerian media now. You've been in the business for a long time.
Yes.
How have we fared in 16 years of consistent democracy? Do you think the media has been fair to politicians or issues of leadership and governance?
I think the media is a reflection of the society. I mean, when the media cannot work in vacuum, we have to work within the context of the country. That you agree with me that it's been very, for you to run a media organization, you have pressure of money, you have a lot of pressure. So that will also influence whatever editorial policies that you have. So the media has been challenged, but I will tell you that we still have a lot of credible media organizations in Nigeria who try as much as possible to be as balanced as possible. It's been challenging. And we've also helped. Don't forget that we're also the media. I personally was harassed during Abacha. I wasn't in any big organization. I was in Fame. We're only doing our jobs. But we're harassed by the DSS. So we also contributed to the democracy that we're enjoying here. So the media played a part in that. And they've also tried as much as possible. We might be criticized that we don't do as much as we should do. But of course, we are doing our best.
Yeah, but I mean, looking at social economic problems that we have in the country, especially we are not being welfareist in nature.
Yes.
And media are not, instead of reporting that, they're celebrating politicians, which is not the norm in Western
I
democracies.
I want to disagree with you. I mean, everyone in Nigeria knows that Osun State before now, weren't paying salaries for months. Everybody knows that about 26 states in Nigeria are struggling with paying salaries. Where did you hear that from? So we're doing our bit. We can't just be reporting all the negatives. Even if you report all the negatives, where are we going to get foreign investors? How are you going to get people to have the confidence in the system? So the media has to do a bit of balancing. Yes, we are having issues. Yes, we are trying to solve those issues.
But a lot of newspaper publishers don't pay salary as well. So it's all same insane. So does it mean that
such a
Nigeria as a society?
I've told you that the media can work within the context of this society. Every business in Nigeria now is struggling. I mean, we don't owe salaries in Ovation. I mean, we try as much as possible to take care of our staff. But I know the problems that we go through when it's the 20th of every month to make sure that we get, because you see the difference between, one of the major problems that we have in the media industry is just a few media organizations are well run. Either they are businessmen that are into media or they are media professionals that are not businessmen. So you have a disconnect in how they run the business. Either they don't run the business properly or, we journalists are very focused on delivering on content. Mm. But the business side of it is not there. So over time, we in Ovation, we've made our mistakes, but we've been able to. So we always see, if you talk to a lot of people who run the business, who are in the media business, you'll see how difficult it is. Because how do we survive? Through advertising. And when the companies are not making money, they are not advertising. So how are we going to get money to run these things?
Fantastic. How international is Ovation? And of course, what brought about the coming of Boss newspaper? I've seen a couple of that online, but yeah. It's not been very consistent. What's the problem?
No, the Boss is very consistent. It's an online newspaper, so it's every day. We report stories, we do interviews and all that. But the thing is, Ovation, in the past, we used to print, we still print in London, and we ship all over the country. All over the world. We ship to America, we ship to Central Europe, we ship to Africa, and we truck. There was a time we had to truck, we used to truck from London to Netherlands and then fly KLM to Nigeria. So it's a very big operation. But you see, in today's world where you have the social media, where everyone is on the internet, we had to reevaluate our business. Can we continue to be shipping? The freight cost, 500 naira to a pound today, and we pay our printers in pounds. So we have to really evaluate our business, and we try to make it as easy for our clients to reach us. So we print, but the printing is not reaching everyone as it used to. We have reduced the print quality and the print quantity, but we still offer we are online and we are on Apple app. You can read us in all those other platforms.
Okay, back in your days, we had journalists who had a passion for the job.
Yes.
We've been there for a long time. And then it wasn't for the money. It was
profession. Sure.
But now, the kind of editors, reporters you see on the street now, what can you really say?
As a media trainer myself, because I also do that on the side, I try to train our people. The thing is, the first thing you need to have is passion for whatever you want to do. And after that, the educational system that we're running in Nigeria is even a problem. When you have a graduate that cannot string one or two paragraphs together, and that is a graduate of mass comm. So if you cannot string stories together, how will you even know what is news? So you have a challenge. And like I said, we are a function of the society. The educational system has collapsed. And so you don't have the kind of quality. Listen to the radio station, listen to the TV stations. When I'm driving and I'm listening to radio and I hear people pronounce certain words, I say, what? Simple words that, before you go on air, I remember when I used to work in Radio Lagos, just to say good evening, you had to train for like 5-6 months to say it properly on radio before they allow you to even get near the mic.
But that's
that was then. But now anybody just goes on radio and you listen to the pronunciation and you are so irritated, you are so mad. But that is the system, and people are not complaining anyway.
It's just a norm here.
It's unfortunate. Quality has dropped everywhere.
Okay, what can we do to improve on it? And now that you've gone international, into broadcasting.
Yes, Ovation TV.
How do you think you're going to sustain it? And what should people expect from Ovation?
Ovation TV is just a lifestyle, just an extension of the magazine, a lifestyle channel that is running as the 1 hour now, but we're also expanding. We're looking at other platforms, and we're on YouTube and other other platforms.
And you're on Ben TV.
We're on Ben TV.
So are you going to have a proper TV station in the future?
Well, it is in the plan. But we, if you know my publisher, Dele Momodu, he always like to take it one step at a time. So this TV thing has been on for maybe 7 years. We've been trying to plan it and all that. So it's a gradual process. It's something that will crystallize into owning a TV station, mm-hmm. I'm sure.
Okay. Michael, you always trip me because I've known you since back in
yes.
the days. So how can you say the good and the bad and the ugly side of your journalist experience?
You mean personally?
Personally.
Yeah, the good side is, as a celebrity journalist, you are able to meet people that you only see on TV. You meet them one-on-one, they become your friends. For example, one of the greatest African leaders that we have today, that even Nigerians always talk about, is Jerry Rawlings, because of what he did for Ghana. I was privileged to interview him for 8 hours, spanning 2 days. So those kind of moments, you know, bring a lot of joy to your heart. A lot of, I've attended events, I've interviewed people that, you know, when you tell people that you've done this, say, oh, you actually met this man. Yes, I've met him, I've spoken to him. We're even friends, I have his number, I can call him. So those are the good things about journalism. But the other side is there's no money.
Is that what people call boring?
As a journalist, you should know. Anyway, seriously now, we are underpaid as journalists. But you see, if you have passion, like I say, I do this job because I love it. So even if I'm not paid, I'm happy.
It makes you happy. Okay, what's your final message for a lot of people watching us in the diaspora, watching us right now? What will you say to them? This is what is in the next pipeline for Ovation.
I'll say to them that keep believing in Nigeria. Because if Nigeria is doing well, Ovation will do well, Larry will do well, Ben TV will do well. So keep believing in Nigeria. Things are rough, yes. But with us talking about it, reflecting on it, I'm sure things will be better and we'll all be smiling very soon.
Mike Helfer, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Larry.
We appreciate you a lot.
This opportunity to
and
talk.
We will call you in the near future.
No problem.
Thank you.
Always.
Viewers, it's been with Michael Helfer, a very good friend of mine. He's been in this business for quite a while. Hope you enjoy that. He is the editor of Ovation International. We've been talking about journalism in Nigeria, most especially celebrity journalism. We still have a lot of wonderful package. Don't go away. We'll be right back. I want to say thank you for giving the state the upliftment you needed. Yes, I would like to ask you, you've been on the saddle for 5 years now, and you still have three more good years. What have been your challenges over the years? You've taken the state to greater heights. What has been the challenge so far?
Yeah, thank you very much. Firstly, I want to say we give sincere thanks to God Almighty for keeping us healthy and alive to have moved the state in the last 5 years. We've seen ourselves taking quite a few things we made on ground to completion levels. We've seen ourselves initiating new areas, and we've seen ourselves putting new things we intend to take to completion levels before the end of our tenure. These areas largely cut across our human capital development activities in health, in education, and of course, we're looking at the economic activities where we've sought to empower our entrepreneurs, creating new entrepreneurs, getting them access to funds, and most importantly, again, getting them to see how borrowing and lending work in wealth creation. And of course, that has translated into generating another level of inclusive banking. And of course, we've worked intensively on infrastructure, especially in roads. Critically, a lot of our people live in rural environments, so it's been quite necessary for us to ensure that we create linkages to allow for vehicular and people movement, and we begin to see a lot more ease in exchange of goods and services, which of course, again, we see translate into improved activities. There's been some little pressure on that because we've had quite a very peaceful environment in Kwara. We've tried to be as receptive as we can So it's created the platform for influx of a lot of people. And of course, this sees pressure coming in on infrastructure. We've been trying to see how to move on in supporting areas of water supply, electricity, and most importantly, healthcare services. So these are some of the areas we've been creating some upscaling to meet up with the current challenges. The biggest challenge we've been faced with in the last few years had been that of resources. Our resources went southwards when the drop in commodity price, as we're aware, affected the inflows of revenue, which truly, of course, impacted, of course, on what we get. As it is, as a state, we've sought for other areas, improved revenue generation, and of course, cut down in our costs, which has translated into our being able to marshal new areas to deploy infrastructural developments for our good people in Kwara. So far, I say it's been quite tough, especially in the first year of the second term, vis-a-vis the first year of the first term. But I'll say that we've impacted positively on people's lives in areas of economic infrastructure and, of course, human capital development in the last 5 years.
Okay. And what would be the incentives that you have or strategies for Nigerian diaspora who want to come and invest in Kwara State? In what sectors of the economy would you like them to come and invest?
Yes, you would see that with the current challenges we're faced with in the country, we're faced with a situation where we have to begin to see how to waken up our latent potentials. This has to do with looking at what we truly can make available to prospective investors, both local and, of course, and abroad. To us, one of the critical strengths we see in driving incentives for investors is the human population here. We have a very huge population whose ages range between 15 and 65, in about 60% of the population, which tells you that they had a strong workforce. We are bothered here with River Niger, which of course we know is the longest river in West Africa and one of the longest in Africa, which gives a lot of fresh water all year round, which tells you that this place can truly see itself moving into a Greek economy. And of course, again, we have a good network of roads that links up the north and southern part of the country, and of course the central part of the country. We have a good airport here. We can be linked by the rail. So it tells you that in terms of vehicular and people movement, we're quite accessible. And most importantly, again, we have a receptive environment. Our people here are good in terms of reception, and you've since seen the growth in the population of people around here, which of course speaks of the reception of our people here. Our land access policies are quite easy. We've tried to see how you can access land for use for investment purposes through a one-stop shop, which we've created under a Bureau for Land, driven by a DG who has put everything in an electronic system and makes it easy for you to access land. And of course, we have a flexible tax collection system. To the extent of tax that are collectible within the confines of what the states can do, we try to create areas of deferrals, areas of waivers where we can to make it easy for prospective investors. By and large, these are areas we've worked on to ease the levels to which things go in accessing investment opportunities in Kwara. And I'm telling you that it's quite receptive and we've been receiving quite some attention.
Okay, you've done so well, and we've seen a lot of activities in the government in the last 5 years. But you have to beat your chest and say, what kind of legacy do you want to leave when you bow out in another 3 years?
Well, by the time we leave in 3 years, we want to see that we have truly changed our people's lives in terms of access to proper medical care, proper education, access to good roads, access to good water to drink, and most importantly, the attitude to our people to understanding how government opportunity can be used to translate into wealth creation would have changed. And would see that our people would truly understand that governance is a joint activity between the people and the governing agency. So when we begin to see how complementary our roles are, we begin to see that Kwara State will not be the same again. God's willing, by the time we leave, would have left a much more developed Kwara State in infrastructure, would have left a much more developed Kwara State in educational support, and would have left a lot more improved economic environment, because would have brought in platforms for individuals, corporate institutions who would come to latch on these opportunities to set up businesses that can employ our youths, create food on the table, and make the economy peaceful. These are some of the things we hope to leave as legacies, God's willing, when we leave in 2019.
Have we improved our IGRs yet? Since the money coming from the center is not into riding about.
Yes, I would have mentioned that. I was just looking at the time frame you have. I would have told you that one of the biggest legacies we're happy with is changing the revenue generating agency of the state. We looked at the new challenges, and we brought in a platform built on a tripod concept of people, process, and technology. We changed this. We changed it in line with the current exigencies of need to upscale our revenue generating scheme. And I'm happy to let you know that this has since made a difference to what is collectible in the state. And we hope, God's willing, within the next 2 years, would have done over close to 1,000% in our revenue generating efforts. This will truly create the much desired revenue that will see Kwara State running as a state on its own, rather than dependent on federally allocated funds.
Okay, that means the economy is good and the state is moving forward.
Sure.
But lastly, before we go, a lot of Kwara indigenous watching you in the diaspora all over the world on our global platform. We'd like to hear from them. Mr. Governor, what do you intend to do for them if they decide to relocate back home?
The opportunities are enormous. Like I said, we've created a desk which we call the Public-Private Partnership Desk, which allows you to see the various opportunities we have in all the sectors that you derive competence in, i.e. you have interest in agriculture. You can get all the information you want from this desk to see how you key in as a private individual. And we have platforms in all ministries that demonstrates our policies towards opportunities that are available, i.e. opportunities are available in water supply, opportunities are available in energy schemes, opportunities are available in even light manufacturing. All these are made available through the Public-Private Partnership Office, where you can access information, see potentials, and see how you key in into the chain. And of course, drive yourself as an entrepreneur.
Okay, Mr. Governor, thank you very much for giving us this time. Of course, we hope to see you some other time. Thank you very much, sir.
I'm so delighted. Thank you so much.